Hey there, guys. Eric Farrar, broker co-owner, 1850 Realty. And today we're going to discuss expectations around requests for repair from both the selling and buying perspective. So we've had a couple of these issues that have come up as we've represented selling clients. And it's been interesting. We don't get to pick who brings an offer and who brings a buyer and what they expect. But we just want to cover some basics to go over, and this can kind of touch on both sides at the same time. So, you know, one of the key things that we really want to impress is that buyers have their diligence to inspect the property so they know exactly what they're getting into. And as a seller, you want to make sure you allow the buyer to investigate. That way, they're all in. They're happy with what they're getting. Along those lines, so if we look at RPA page 6, if you can see here, it clearly says, seller has no obligation to agree or respond. It is a request for repairs. And if we go to the request for repair form, same type of thing. Note, seller has no obligation to respond. Pretty clear at this point. You know, you've got two different documents asking or letting you know what's going to happen, that you get to ask, the seller doesn't have to respond at all. We like to play fair. We don't like to do that. And typically we focus on health and safety issues. And sometimes these things come up. It could be an as innocuous as return springs on your garage door, which is a fire rated door, you know, out of expiration, carbon monoxide detectors, stuff like that. These things happen. But a couple of things that have come up recently, you know, we have a recent property that we went back and forth on, 17 item list. And we had another one that we had as a listing. If you can see, this is two pages, it's 36 items. It's basically, both of these are the entire inspection report covering things like sliding screen door does not latch. I mean, you can ask, but it's really not expected that a seller is going to start replacing tiny little things that have existed the entire time they've owned their property. You know, when you're buying a used home, it's not new construction. And, you know, none of these things on either of these were really health and safety items at all. There was something about some vent screens missing on a home, you know, a house built in 1954. You know, there's going to be some odds and ends that need to be done. Fairly standard. Our client was working on their property the entire time they owned it, and they inherited a lot of these issues, and the person that's going to buy it is going to inherit some of these things that have been going on this property for probably upwards of 30, 40 years. Not a big deal. Roof's not leaking. Everything works. You just want to be mindful, if you're going to put one of these things together, that you have expectations of what's going to happen after the fact. You know, we've seen a lot where folks have said, oh, well, the water heater's old. It's past its life expectancy. Well, if it's not leaking and it's working, it's really tough to have a seller decide to give you a brand new water heater when there's no deficiency being experienced with the one in hand. We run into this on furnace and HVAC quite often, where the units are fairly old but functional, 100%. We have SDG&E or an HVAC contractor come out to check furnaces, to check the burners, to make sure they're not emitting CO. We have had one unit red tagged in that process. That was a health and safety issue. Heating's mandatory. So we worked a concession out with our client, the selling side, and passed that along to the buyer. That was something they needed to do. These things come up. So, you know, we just want to make sure that everybody on both sides has a reasonable expectation, and these are some of the things you can run into. And you might ask, Eric, so how would you prepare a request for repair that is going to be accepted? Well, you want to pick the top number of things that you really want. You don't want to overshoot, because when you send one of these out like this, you're likely to enrage the other side, especially when you're asking for 17 items and have the other party do all the research on who's going to come out, get bids, bid it out, you know, so on and so forth. What you want to do if there are repairs is to get a second opinion and a bid. So usually when you're at a home inspection as a buyer, The inspector's going to point out, hey, the HVAC is past life expectancy, or there's something in the burners I don't think's right. We want to get HVAC contractor out immediately. That way we can get a bid. And same thing with roofs. There's a lot of problems with tile roofs where tiles are slipping. There's valleys that they're not properly spaced, so the shingles can become too close where there should be a gap to let the water out. And again, typically, you know, they call these roof tune-ups, where they go and reseal vent pipes and things. And, you know, they're anywhere from $500 to $1,000. Not horrific. But it could be the difference in having a roof that leaks or not. You know, we're not asking for roof replacement, but these things do happen. And we want to be mindful that we're bringing facts to the other party, especially when you're asking for big ticket items. So those are a couple things to keep in mind. Anyway, we're going to wrap this one up with that, and we'll see you on the next chat. If you have any questions, never hesitate to let us know.